Well, good morning everyone. I'm here in a beautiful forest in the center of Germany, and what you see here around me is actually wild garlic. So the smell, if you could smell it, it's quite nice if you like it. So, and yeah, it's in full bloom. So I came here just the right time. So I've actually visited this forest 2 weeks ago just to check it out, to see where the garlic fields are. And yeah, now this morning I made a very early start, like 3:30 in the morning, drove up here, and yeah, now I'm walking through this beautiful forest, have it nearly for myself, and except for the birds. And although it's very beautiful, it's actually quite hard to photograph and to find compositions, because it's a national park and I'm kind of bound to the trails and to, yeah, the pathways leading through the forest, and I have to look for the compositions I find along the way. And this can be, as usual for woodland, quite hard, especially if you're then constrained to just a very small radius. So what you can always do, and I've said this I think in previous videos about woodland photography, if it's hard to find order in the chaos to find compositions, yeah, you can look for some trails winding through the trees, or also rivers work, little streams. But yeah, what I found here is this road, and yeah, it's kind of curving into the forest back there, and with a long lens I can zoom in and have just the greenery of the trees and then the wild garlic to the side of the road, and it looks quite beautiful. What I'm now doing is just waiting a bit, because yeah, from time to time the sun peeks through the clouds, and yeah, then I get some quite nice light, although with this subdued light it also looks very nice. So woodland photography, really, if you don't have any sun, doesn't matter. Usually it looks quite nice if you have some greenery, but that little touch of light can actually make it special. So that's why I'm waiting a bit longer, hope that the sun comes through once more, and then I get a bit of side light, some streaks of light across the road and through the forest. This would make this, yeah, photo even better. But yeah, at least now I found my first composition. I think that's always good if you have a long drive, you're coming to a location and getting that first shot, which sometimes takes longer, sometimes you get it right away, sometimes you don't get it at all, but getting it, this calms me down, and I at least have one photo now. And yeah, now it's time to explore a bit more, because this forest is huge. I can, I think, walk for 10, 15, 20 kilometers, all those trails, and I'll have, yeah, this wild garlic all around. So hopefully I find a few more compositions, and I'll bring you along, also talk you through a few of those, and yeah, we'll see what we get. So I'm glad to say I found a spot where I could do my first kind of wide angle composition of the wild garlic with some trees. And yeah, I was just following the smell, so to say. So I was walking like 4 or 5 kilometers, and in between there was no wild garlic at all. So there are patches in this forest where you don't have that, yeah, canopies of wild garlic. But then suddenly, maybe 100 meters before I actually saw it, I could already smell it. So I knew I was on the right track. So I went on, and yeah, I found this patch of, yeah, forest with the wild garlic, and the light's actually quite nice now. So we have some spotlights here throughout the forest, and yeah, I was also able to get a little bit closer without trampling any of the garlic. So there's actually here a bit of a path, I don't know, so I could get the camera quite close. And yeah, I'm currently photographing this scene with those beech trees, and then a lot of wild garlic, then some greenery behind. And then what's also helping here is that I'm kind of descending into a valley, which means on this side there's a slope going up, so I don't have any sky behind those trees, which is always kind of distracting if you have trees and then sky behind it. Those are the high contrast areas which are hard to deal with in a photograph, but here it's quite perfect. So I have really just greenery with just a few little patches of sky peeking through, but I think this is gonna work. So yeah, what I did, and I have to be careful when I get to the camera now, I'm set up quite low here and I'm zoomed in at 35 millimeters. If I'm zoomed in at that range, I need to do quite a bit of focus stacking here, especially with those white garlic flowers quite close to the camera. And yeah, I've said this in past videos already, and it's becoming kind of my favorite feature of the R5. I'm again using the automatic bracketing. So I might start at the back, getting in bracketed exposures for dynamic range, and then I just focus on getting in front to back sharp. And since I've been asked about the settings, I'm just gonna repeat those or show those again, what I have here for the R5 for the automatic focus bracketing. So if you look here, now it's disabled, but don't worry, the number of shots is key. Just select a very high number. The camera will actually not take that many photos. It will stop before. But if you set the number too low, it might stop before it reached the end with a focus. Also here, the focus increment, I have it at the left, so making it very tiny ranges between the focus. And what you do, you focus as close to the foreground as possible. You can even use manual focusing for that. Then make sure to have autofocus enabled, and when you then trigger the focus bracketing with a 2-second timer to be sure you don't have any shake, the camera will start taking photos at the front where you focused, going further backwards until it reaches far infinity, so the far end of the lens. And this usually happens before it reaches 40 photos, especially if you're shooting with a wide angle lens. If you're shooting macro, that's different. You might even take a higher number than 40, but usually it's between 5 and 10 photos. Also, the last 3 or 4 photos often are very unsharp because you have the camera focusing past infinity, or yeah, past the infinity sharp point. I'm not sure how to say it. I hope this makes sense. So in the end, you can just select from the photos, and as I showed in a previous video, simply blend it. And here today also was careful to check the weather forecast to have a day without, or nearly without, any wind. What you always do, or what I always do, also repeat the session of bracketing with a higher ISO. Also change the f-stop, the aperture a bit, to see if you can get a range with f9.5, which would mean optimal focus, optimal sharpness, but you have a tinier depth of field, so it might be harder to blend. And repeat the sequence with like f13 or f16, which gives you larger depth of field with a bit less sharpness, but it might be easier to blend, and at home you can just see what works. Okay, so enough with this little excursion. I'm gonna continue looking for compositions. Also down this way looks quite nice. Let me show you. So here the pathway and the light. So really nice place here. And yeah, I'm still kind of the only person here, although it's weekend, so it was really worth it getting up early and doing the long drive in the dark. So a little update now. I've been now walking around this forest for like 5 hours, and I've taken around 300 or 400 photos, which equates to like 10 different compositions, because focus stacking, exposure blending, different ISOs, there was wind, so a lot of photos. And hopefully one or two turn out nice. So I hope to get at least one portfolio photo out of this trip. But yeah, for this video, I think it's nearly finished, at least the in the field portion of it. What we're now gonna do, I'll head back to the office and then I'm gonna show you the different compositions, the different scenes I photographed, and yeah, we're gonna dissect them a bit, see if there's actually anything good, because it's always one thing on the little screen, it often looks nice, then it really has to stand the test looking at it on the big screen. And yeah, we're gonna do this together, and maybe I learned something, or you also, so we learned something from the failures I did in the field, but hopefully there aren't too many. We'll see now. So in the video so far, you've seen three photos which are fully processed, and yeah, I'm glad to say those three are currently portfolio shots. So I got what I wanted, and now we're gonna look at all the photos, all the different compositions I took. So I have here a selection of in total 14 photos, and I actually took 700. So really with all the focus stacking and exposure blending, everything, but that's not too bad, because now what I do is basically just sifting through the photos, finding the ones I like, and then selecting of those photos, where I sometimes have 50 for just one photo. So focus stacking, different ISOs, all the stuff. I select maybe 5 to 10 photos which I use for the processing. All the others I later just delete. So of those 700 photos in the end, maybe I keep 100 or so. Okay, so now let's look at the photos and see what's good, what's not so good, what I could have improved. So this here was the first photo I shot, and it's quite nice because of all the garlic here and also this tree a little in the foreground, which has some lower branches here. But all in all, what I'm missing here is a little bit of perspective or something leading in the frame. So here we have a very horizontal line of the wild garlic, so there's a very strict separation between foreground and background, or let's say middle ground here. And it's good that this tree is standing out a bit, but still, for this photo I was hoping to get some light, because as I said, I had scouted this forest 2 weeks before, so I kind of knew this scene here. So I wanted to quickly go there in the morning, get a photo possibly with some light, but I didn't get it. And this photo here is similar. I like this a little bit more because of the lighter background. So with some diffusion techniques and post, I could make this look quite interesting. And also here the foreground is not that monotone. So here we have some patches of reddish leaves in between. So yeah, it's also, it's a nice photo, but I'm also not yet sure of it. Now we come to the road, which I showed you. And yeah, this is a shot which I took when the sky was overcast, and I said, okay, I'd like to wait a bit longer. I didn't get the light though when I was standing there the first time. Just when I came back 5 hours later, this is when I got the light, and this is also the photo I processed because it gives it more dimension, makes it more interesting, and also a little different to the other photos I shot. So the other photos I showed you now were more like taken under a very soft overcast sky, soft light, and this here is very different. Here I have direct sunlight in the trees. Yeah, this makes this little portfolio which I created a little more diverse. Now this photo is the first one I shot in the little grove in which I also recorded the video, and this here I like quite a bit because it looks a bit more dynamic than, for example, the first photo where we had just this horizontal line of white garlic versus the trees. And here we have this diagonal also with some beautiful soft light here, and then those beautiful trees which are also nicely lit up but not with direct light. And here it's a little darker, another slope going down. So we have quite some depth here, and I think this is also a photo which I'm gonna process. Now, here's the one which I showed you in the video. It's just maybe 10 meters to the right of this one here. And here we're looking down into the valley, and there's the slope going up, which, as I said, basically allows me to take a photo without any sky in it. And yeah, I like this from the composition. We have this group of trees here kind of standing out, then lots of greenery. We have this slope here in the background with some reddish leaves. So all in all, quite nice. And in the processing, you already saw this. I was selecting some of the photos where there wasn't even much light here in the background. So everything, all the focus is here on this carpet of white garlic. And also here again, this is more of a diagonal going through the frame versus the first photos where we had this horizontal. So it makes it more dynamic. Also this going down and then upwards. For me, that's a nicely balanced photo. Now we continue when I walked down the slope, and here I was attempting my first real wide angle shot. Wanted to go for a very dynamic composition also with some nice foreground. And it looks quite nice. The only problem I have with this one, on the little display, this tree here, it didn't look as dominant as it now does here in this photo. So I think this is a little bit too much, although I really like the view down into the valley. But for this photo, I should have gone a little back from this tree, so make it a little smaller. So I'm not sure if I'm gonna process this one. So what I did here, this is the same tree, so I went down the track. Yeah, this one also, again, we have some diagonals here. We have the foreground, all the white garlic leading into the scene. And here we have some very bright patches of sky. So I'm not yet sure how this is gonna look if I process it, but I think I'm gonna give this one a try just because of the nice colors, and also here because I like the perspective quite a bit. Now, further down, I came upon this carpet of wild garlic. So it was a slope just next to the road and all this wild garlic. And here I like the perspective because I kind of looking up here and also can look in between the wild garlic. So I have all those leaves pointing towards the camera and then up the slope into the trees. And I worked a bit more on this composition. So the photo I showed you in the video was based on this. I basically found that here the balance is not so nice. So we're starting up here in the upper left going down, and here we already have this thick tree, and then to the right side there's not too much to balance it. So it feels quite heavy on this side because also here's much more of the wild garlic versus this side here. So what I did, I rather placed this tree more to the right, so it's kind of balancing this side here. So that's at least my idea. So you see, just maybe moving the camera like 30 centimeters to the right, then adjusting a bit the field of view, and you get quite different photos. Afterwards, I went on and tried to capture some photos with a long lens, because again, the light was quite nice. So we have this pathway which I used to guide the viewer through the scene, and I took quite a few photos. So I started with this one. If you think of some scales here, it's leaning a bit to the left side, so the balance is not perfect. So for this here, I moved a little bit to the left, so nearly placing this track in the center, and I think this photo feels more balanced. Also here on the side, I just used this tree as a kind of a border, which sometimes works, sometimes it doesn't, because you don't have a tree to balance it here. But I think for this photo, it's not too much and not too distracting. Also, I might later decide just to crop it out, so I'm still undecided about this, but I'll definitely process this photo here. Then I zoomed in even more. So here I had also the automatic focus stacking, and for such a scene where I'm at 165 millimeters, just as an example, the automatic bracketing, focus bracketing takes like 15 photos. So if I want to stack this manually, this will be quite some work. But again, I just liked how this track leads through the wild garlic into the distance, and I might also give this one a try later on. So that's just one thing here. If you're photographing woodland, it's always good to have both a wide angle lens and also a zoom lens, because if you don't find those wide angle compositions, just zooming in sometimes reveals the order you're looking for. It makes the scenes much more simple, so you can reduce everything you have in a wide angle image to just a few trees or fewer trees. Also, trees are closer together, and just by moving the camera a tiny bit, you can
create quite some order, but not always. Here we're back with the wide angle lens. So I found this nice grove where I have this tree sticking out and then this one. So it's kind of a going down, going up like a V shape. And also I liked this little detail here. So this hole in the tree and yeah, as usual, all the wild garlic around it. I'm not yet sure how I will process this one and even if I will process it, but it's gonna be interesting how I deal with that tree here because it's a bit dominant, could be distracting, so I have to see how I'm gonna work with it in post. So either darkening it a bit or I'm not sure yet. And then yeah, here in the end, what I already showed you, the photo of the road. So yeah, there you have it, 5 or 6 hours in the woods without the perfect light. So I really, in the morning, I wanted some soft light shining through the trees, but still a mix of overcast sky and then some direct light can still provide some great opportunities to take beautiful photos if you just find that order and the chaos. Because this wood, it's huge, this forest, but finding those compositions which I just showed you, and you saw even it's just like 13 which I found and not all of them are good, so it's kind of hard finding those. And it's also why you need to have a lot of patience when you photograph woodland. You need to bring time, you have to walk, you have to go into different directions, so really explore. And sometimes you not even get a photo. So here, as I said, I was there already 2 weeks earlier and explored a bit, and now I explored more. So this is always what you need to do when you want to find those beautiful subjects in the forest. It's different to the typical landscape photography where you show up at a spot which you already have a clear image in your head, what you want to photograph, how it will look. You've likely seen photos of that spot already. With woodland, it's quite different. And this is also what I like a lot about woodland photography, because you can usually come away with a lot of photos which nobody has taken like that before. Okay, so that's the end of the video. I hope you found it interesting. If so, please leave a thumbs up, subscribe to the channel, and yeah, see you in the next video. Bye.